surprised, all happy about it. And then she informs me that I've left a section out.
Oh my goodness, this 5-section tree ended up having a ledge on it, but I did not say anything. I just put the ornaments on that and moved on.
Didn't
and
want to do it yourself, did you?
No, I did not. I was so thankful that you did it.
And you know what? That was one of our best Christmas trees ever.
Yes.
See the sunrise here. Come, let's stand to our feet and let's make this proclamation today. Sing it with me.
Isn't that an incredible way to start this Christmas season? Welcome. So good to see you this morning. It is wonderful to be in God's house this morning with our family of faith to worship the Lord together today. This is going to be an incredible week. This weekend, this choir and orchestra is going to be presenting a Christmas in the Ville. We hope to have a packed house both Saturday and Sunday evenings. Invite someone. They're going to hear the gospel being shared during this presentation, and hope you'll invite others to come with you. Let me share just a word or two, and in just a moment we have a presentation to make, but we're looking forward to 2022 with our mission trips starting again. Over the last couple of years, we just haven't been able to be involved in the trips as we have been in the past, but we're going full blast this next year. Three different areas that we're going to be ministering. First, to our mission partnership in Guatemala. We have three trips planned next year to Guatemala to help our partner church in Huehuetenango. We also have 13 trips planned to help our church plant in Hell's Kitchen, New York City. In fact, be sure you, if you're not praying for Chris and Sarah, do so. Just a little bit over 6 weeks or so away, they're going to have the official launch on January the 16th. We're going to start a 30-day season of prayer for them in just a few days, but you be praying as they officially launch. And then also this summer, we're going to be helping several churches in Alaska have Vacation Bible School. That was our emphasis with our Vacation Bible School this past year as we raised money. And we're going to be sending teams as well as funds to help them have Vacation Bible School. So we're looking forward. So there's a table out in the foyer. Our missions minister, Mike McClanahan, some of his mission team will be out there. Go by. If you can't participate by physically going, you can certainly go by, get some information, and pray for them as well. I want to say a word of welcome to guests. We're so happy you're here today. You have honored us by just being present today. Blessed to see guests in our early service. I know we do in this one as well. Pastor and I would love to meet you at the end of the service. We're going to be out in the foyer. Please come by. Let us say thank you for being here today and just honor you. Let's bow together in prayer this morning. Our Father, as we gather this morning as a family of faith, Lord, we do so for one reason and one reason only, and that is to honor you, to give glory to you, to worship you. Lord, you and you alone are worthy of our worship. We certainly worship you for what you've done. You've blessed us. Your word tells us to proclaim the mighty works of God. And Lord, day after day, week after week, we see how you have blessed us. You blessed us this past week with having an incredible, incredible evening of worship for our women on Thursday night. We thank you for that. You've blessed in our next gen ministries in so many ways, and we praise you and we thank you. But Lord, even more though than how we have seen you work, Lord, we praise you and worship you for who you are. Lord, you are God. You alone are worthy of our worship. May we focus on you this morning through every song that's sung, through every word that's spoken, through the message that's proclaimed. Fill our pastor with your spirit, anoint him. Lord, but prepare us for the reception of your word. Lord, every time that you speak to us, you want us to be different, and I pray that we will be ready to listen intently and to respond as your Holy Spirit leads. Through Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. Over the last couple of years, our pastors had the privilege of serving as president of the Tennessee Baptist Convention. He concluded that service just a couple of weeks ago with the annual gathering of the Tennessee Baptist Convention. But we're privileged this morning to have Dr. Randy Davis with us. Dr. Davis is the executive director, treasurer of the Tennessee Baptist Mission Board. And Pastor, if you'll come as well this morning. Dr. Davis, we're glad you're here this morning.
Thank you, Brother Bruce. Thank you, Bruce. Good to see you. And the past 2 years, Dr. Chesser has led extremely well a network of churches across the state of Tennessee that make up Tennessee Baptist Convention, 3,200 churches. Now, what this entailed is not only presiding over our recent convention that was held in Brentwood, but traveling thousands of miles in the state, going to dozens and dozens of meetings, and preaching from Mountain City to Memphis. And he has done just a wonderful, wonderful work. It is amazing that this is the first time since 1949 that one man has served as president for two consecutive years. Normally, it's a one-year term. But because of the pandemic, Brother Bruce served 2 years, and I cannot think of a greater leader to serve during a pandemic than Dr. Bruce Chesser. And I've got this plaque to present to him as president of the Tennessee Baptist Convention from 2019 to 2021. He worked hard and led graciously, and I love him.
Thank you, Randy. Appreciate it. Thank you, brother. Thanks. Thanks. Thank you. Thank you. Dr. Davis, you gave me a nice plaque, but I've got something to give you today, too. I'm glad you could come up here. We've got a little check for $200,000. That cost more than this plaque did. Yeah.
Thank you.
Let me tell you about this. This year, you will give $700,000 to the Cooperative Program, which supports our missions and ministries, Tennessee, United States, around the world. You'll give $700,000 through our budget. You'll give $100,000 through the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for missions. You'll give $100,000 through the Annie Armstrong Easter offering for North American missions. You'll give $50,000, I think it is, through the Golden offering for Tennessee missions. As we ended our budget year, our stewardship team looked at how we were blessed, and we didn't feel it was right to just hoard that. We wanted to use that. And so our leadership team decided that we would take $200,000 and we would see a bigger picture than just ourselves. So what we want you to do is to put $100,000 of this on top of what we're already giving to the Cooperative Program. We want $25,000 more to go to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for international missions, $25,000 more to go to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering for North American missions, $25,000 more to go to the Golden offering for Tennessee missions, and that leaves $25,000. And we just signed a couple of weeks ago, Randy and I signed together with the president of the Pacific Hawaiian Baptist Convention. We signed a new partnership, and we want to give $25,000 to help churches in Hawaii. Any of you want to sign up for this trip? To have help churches in Hawaii have vacation Bible schools for their children. Just like this summer, we're helping Alaska. The next summer, we want to be able to help churches in Hawaii. So this is from our church out of the abundance of what God gave us this year. Lord bless you.
If I could thank you folks for your incredible generosity, all of this comes on top of, and I don't know the figure off the top of my head, but I believe it's something like $175,000 that First Baptist Hendersonville gave to disaster relief in the wake of helping with the recovery in Waverly. And just this morning, there was an urgent plea that went out for people to finish sheetrock finishers and electricians, because we're trying to get some of the people back in their houses by Christmas, and you've been a part of that. And this extra $100,000 through the Cooperative Program will mean probably that First Baptist Hendersonville this next year will be the number one in our state in Cooperative Program giving to support Great Commission work around the globe. And we all know how Dr. Chesser loves to be number one.
Well, let's stand together again and let's sing "It Came Upon a Midnight Clear."
than at least a million before. Was there any raw expectation, like there was some kind of something in store? Did the sky have to hold back the thunder? Did the moon find new reasons to glow? Could the children somehow sense the wonder? 2,000 Decembers ago, were the sheep as amazed as their shepherds at the new sign that lit up the sky? Did the willow trees whisper excitement to the rivers and streams passing by? Did the joy ricochet off the mountains till it filled up the valleys below? Did all the world sense love abounding 2,000 Decembers ago? Was anyone able to look at the stable and not see a child but a king? I wish I could hear back over the years as heaven and nature sing. Heaven and nature sing.
Did anyone wake with a feeling, a peace that they could not explain?
Thank you, Tanis and choir, orchestra. We're looking forward to this weekend, Saturday and Sunday night. It's at 6 o'clock, and you'll not want to miss it. Plan to be here. Invite somebody to come with you. It's a great music of the season. I didn't say this earlier. Everyone in here probably does not know Dr. Davis. Let me tell you, before he became our executive director for the Tennessee Baptist Mission Board 12 years ago, he was the pastor of the First Baptist Church of Sevierville. And before that, he was the pastor of the First Baptist Church of Morristown. He's a native of South Alabama, but he got to Tennessee just as quick as he could. And he is a great, great blessing to me personally and a dear friend. And so glad to have him with us. His wife, Jeannie, will be with us in the next service. Well, take your Bible today and find Philippians chapter 4. We're going to finish the book of Philippians today. We started this back in July, and so we've been going on it now for a little over 5 months, and we've come to the conclusion of it. And then we'll have a couple of weeks that we'll look, as you would expect, at the passages related to the birth of Christ. And then after the first of the year, we're going to start a study in the letter of 1 John. I'm looking forward to that and already studying toward that, and believe that that'll be a great passage as well. Now, as we come to these last words, just the last section of this letter that Paul wrote, remember that he wrote it as a thank you note. He's in prison in Rome, and the church in Philippi, which is long away, far away from Paul. They're in Macedonia, he's in Italy, in Rome, and they've heard about his need, and they sent some help to him. And he has written this letter as a thank you note. Now, in the course of the letter, in the body of the letter, he started out thanking them, and then he talked about some other things. It's just a very joyful letter. That's the theme of the book. But you would expect, just like when you write a letter and you have a purpose for the letter, you often come back at the end, you come back to the original purpose. And that's what he does now. He comes back to the purpose of writing it to start with. He's saying thank you to them once again for what they have done. So let's pick up in verse 14, and we'll read to the end of the chapter. He says, still you did well by sharing with me in my hardship. And you Philippians know that in the early days of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving except you alone. For even in Thessalonica, you sent gifts for my needs several times. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that is increasing to your account. But I've received everything in full, and I have an abundance. I'm fully supplied, having received from Epaphroditus what you provided, a fragrant offering, a welcome sacrifice, pleasing to God. And my God will supply all your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Now to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. Greet every saint in Christ Jesus. These brothers who are with me greet you. All the saints greet you, but especially those from Caesar's household. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Now let's talk for just a minute before I get into the body of this. Let's talk about the ending of it, because there at the very end, he ends this book with a doxology. Now, he started it with a prayer. Chapter 1, verse 3, every time I think about you, I thank God for you. When you get on down to verse 9, he says, I pray this, that your love may abound. He started with a prayer. He ends with a doxology. Now, when you and I hear that word doxology, we think about that song that we sang when we were young. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. That's the doxology. But doxology is a word that really, it's made up of two words. Doxo means to praise or to honor. And the second part of the word is from the word logos. So it's words of praise. It's words to honor God. It's words to thank God. So he says, I'm writing you this thank you note, but I want you to know all praise and all thanks and all glory goes to God, because God is the giver of all good and perfect gifts. Then he says, the saints send greetings to you. All the saints who are here send greetings. And he makes a very interesting statement. It reminds me of Romans chapter 16 when he says, the saints at Caesar's house send greetings. Now, how did saints get in Caesar's house? How did these people become believers in the home of the emperor? Well, the gospel has gone forth, and the gospel never returns void. God's word never returns void. That's why we're giving Bibles through the Gideons. That's what that's all about, because God's word never returns void. And any way that we have the opportunity to get God's word out, we ought to do that. And so the gospel has gone forth, and many people have come to faith in Christ. Now, this is a passage. Let's go back to verse 14. Let's work our way through this. This is a passage about giving. It's about giving. They have given a gift to him, and he's writing them a thank you note, and he summarizes now everything that's been said with some very important ideas. Now, the first thing I want you to notice is in verse 14, and that is, it's a privilege to give. Did you know it's a privilege to be able to give? You know why it's a privilege? Because you can't give if you don't have. I heard my mother say 1,000 times when I was a boy, I don't know where she got this phrase, and it never made sense to me when I was a kid. As I got older, I began to understand what she was saying. I heard my mom say 1,000 times, you can't get blood out of a turnip. Well, of course you can't get blood out of a turnip. A turnip doesn't have blood. But then I came to understand what she was saying. You can't get something out of something that's not there. You can't give what you don't have. And by the way, God doesn't expect you to give what you don't have. I think sometimes people play this little game with God. Well, if I had more, I'd do this and I'd do this. God, let me win the lottery and I'll just show you what I'll do. You know, God's not as interested in what you would do if you had more time or more talent or more money. Let me tell you what God is interested in. He's interested in what you will do with what you have. He's interested in what you will do with the time that you have and the resources that you have and the talent that you have. What will you do with what you have? Now, you can't give what you don't have. And so he is telling us that giving is a privilege. Look at how he starts verse 14. He says, still you did well by sharing with me. Now, why did he use that word still? Still you did well. Well, it's because he just got through telling them. We studied this last week. He just got through saying, hey, I haven't been standing by the mailbox waiting for this gift. I haven't been twiddling my thumbs thinking, what am I going to do if the people at Philippi don't send me some money? I haven't been worried about all of this because if you didn't send it, God was going to provide it. If God didn't provide it through you, God was going to provide it in some other way. God was going to provide this need. He just happened to do it through you. But then he says, still, you did well. You did good. You obeyed God. And you gave out of the resources that God had given to you. And I'm praising God, but I want to thank you for what you're doing. So he says it's a privilege to give. But look at the next verse. 15 and 16 says that it is a pleasure to give. Now, let me read this again. I want you to catch some nuances of this passage. He says there in verse 15, you Philippians know in the early days of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving except you alone. For even in Thessalonica, you sent gifts for my need several times. This wasn't their first rodeo. This wasn't the first time they helped Paul. This wasn't the first time they saw a need and said, hey, let's do what we can to help meet Paul's need. They've been in a pattern of doing this. You know why they had that pattern? You know why they did that? Because they had a vision bigger than themselves. You know, the sad tragedy is that there are a lot of churches around us. There are a lot of people who just kind of focus on me and my family and our needs and what we can do, and we just kind of focus on that. I am thankful to be a part of a church that has a bigger vision than just what's going on right here under our roof. I am thankful to be a part of a church that sees that when Jesus said in Acts chapter 1 verse 8 that we should be his witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth, that that's exactly what we ought to be doing. You know how we're doing that? Everything we try to do as a church, everything we try to do here in our community, in Hendersonville, in Gallatin, right here in this area of Middle Tennessee, this is our Jerusalem. That's why we support the Sumner County Food Bank, and thousands and tens of thousands of dollars will be given to feed hungry people in Sumner County this year through your offerings. That's why we support the Sumner County Crisis Pregnancy Center. That's why we support Grace Place. That's why we do what we do here every week. It's to take the gospel to the people that live here, because this is our Jerusalem. But Jesus said that we should take the gospel not only to Jerusalem, but Judea. Now, Judea is a little bit bigger circle. Think about concentric circles. As the circles go out, it's the next circle out. That's why we planted Creekside Church a few years ago. You know, if we had not done that, that church would not be a church today. The doors would have closed. It would have become something else. It would be a community center, or some other group would have taken it over and used it for something else. It would be somebody's warehouse, but it's still a church. It's still proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ, because we understood that was a part of our Judea. That's why we're doing what we're doing right now in Madison. That's why we're supporting Sergio and the work that's going on there. And I'm so happy to tell you that for the first time in two decades this year, they baptized people in their baptistry. They've been meeting in their worship center because you came alongside them and because you gave so that that church could be what God wants her to be. And I'm telling you, for the next decades, every person that comes to faith in Jesus Christ, every family that is touched, every life that is changed, you have a part in that. Because you saw more than just what's happening right here. And you saw that we are to be witnesses not only in Jerusalem, but also in Judea. And then Jesus said in Samaria, and that concentric circle just goes out further. That's why we partnered with Chris Mills. That's why we now have a church plant in New York City on the island of Manhattan, there in Hell's Kitchen. That's why we'll send groups this next year to go and help Chris and Sarah. Now, make no mistake about it. Chris and Sarah were going to plant that church. God had put that on their heart. Like Paul, they weren't sitting there twiddling their thumbs saying, oh, how are we going to do this? We can't do this. And we weren't the heroes that rode up. They were going to plant that church, and God was going to use somebody. God just gave us the privilege of being the ones that he was going to use. And now that's our partner ministry. That's why we're going to send all of those groups to Alaska this summer to help children have vacation Bible school. And the next summer we may be sending groups somewhere else, because we've got a bigger picture than just what's going on right here in our community. Listen, Jesus said, you'll be witnesses to me in Jerusalem. That's here in Judea. That's our larger area in Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth. Did you know that every time you give? Did you know that every time you give, you are supporting 3,600 missionaries around the world through the International Mission Board? Every time you give. Every time you give, you are supporting 6,000 missionaries in Canada and the United States that God has called, that are in places like New York City and Las Vegas, Nevada, and Los Angeles, California. And God has placed them there to try to take the gospel to people who desperately need to hear it. And every time you give a dollar, part of that goes to support the works of those people. Every time you give, you support the work of the Tennessee Baptist Mission Board. Did you know we've got strategists all over this state? They live in every part of this state. How many are there? 7 areas that we have in our state. We've got strategists that live in every part. Now, they may not be able to help us at the First Baptist Church of Hendersonville a whole lot, because we've got a great staff, well-equipped, trained. We've got people that know how to do what they're doing. But I'm telling you, there are a lot of churches that are out there that they don't know how, and they need help. They need somebody to come alongside them. They need somebody to encourage them and to be there for them. And we've got strategists all over this state. We've got missionaries all over this state. And every time you give, you make that possible for those people to help those 3,200 churches across Tennessee. When you give, you support Union University and Carson Newman University and the Tennessee Baptist Children's Home. Hundreds of kids who have, because of life circumstances, they need somebody to love them. They need somebody to give them a place to sleep and food and clothing. And every time you give, you support that. Did you know that we have adult homes here in Tennessee for special needs adults? Did you know we have 8 homes across Tennessee? These are for special needs adults who they can't live independently, but they're not to a point where they need a nursing home. They just need someone to help them live. They just need someone to love them. Every time you give, you support those adult homes across Tennessee. It's a pleasure to be a part of a church that has a vision bigger than ourselves. It's a pleasure to be a part of a church that's not just thinking about what we can do and what we can have and what we can build, but we're thinking about how we can take the gospel to the nations. It's a pleasure to give. That's what he says in this passage. You've been a part of this, and you're a part of it today. Well, look at the third thing that he says. This is a really interesting statement. Not only the privilege of giving and the pleasure of giving, but this next sentence there in verse 17 talks about the profit of giving. Did you know it's profitable to you to give? Blessed is he who gives. That's what the Bible says. Because to whom gives, more will be given. That's what Jesus said. Look at the verse 17. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that is increasing to your account. You're storing up treasure in heaven when you give. God is keeping an account of what you give for his kingdom's work. And God is going to bless you. God is keeping that account, and the fruit of your giving is going to be a blessing in your life somewhere along the way. You know why that's true? Because you can't outgive God. Because you can't outgive God. And the more you give, the more God puts into your account, the more God blesses you for your willingness to give. So there's the profit of giving. The fourth thing I want you to see is in the next verse. It's the praise of giving. Look at the way he words this in verse 18. He says, but I've received everything in full. I have an abundance. I'm fully supplied, having received from Epaphroditus what you provided, a fragrant offering, a welcome sacrifice, pleasing to God. Now, this is what he says. This is a receipt. This is what he's saying. I've been given everything you sent to me. You took up this offering. He may have even listed some things out. I've got the coat that you sent. I've got a blanket. I've got this food that you sent. I've got this money. He's giving a receipt. Everything you sent by Epaphroditus, I have received it in full. I am now well stocked. Thank you so much for what you have done. But look at what he says. He says, it has been received as a welcome sacrifice, pleasing to God. It is a fragrant offering, a welcome sacrifice, pleasing to God. He uses an Old Testament picture that these people understood very well. He used a picture of those old days when they would make a sacrifice of an animal, and they would take that bull, or they would take the meat of that sheep. They would put that animal on the altar, and they would light a fire under it, and the smoke would begin to billow. And as they would see that smoke going up into the heavens, it was their understanding that that sacrifice was pleasing to God. And it was almost as though the aroma of that smoke was going into the nostrils of God, and that God found that sacrifice to be pleasing. He said, what you have given is a sacrifice, and it is a praise offering, and it is flowing up into the very nostrils of God. You didn't just give to help me. You gave to worship God. You know, one of the things I think we've lost with COVID, and I hate that this has happened. Maybe one day we can get back to this. I miss the days when we passed the offering plate. You know why? Not because we got more offering that way. I don't think we did. You're continuing to be faithful. It's working the way we're doing it. But that was a part of worship. And even if you didn't give it right at that moment, even if you had given it online or you had given it in a connect group, it was that moment that was an act of worship. Greg, Bruce, we need to do a better job at making sure that at some time during a worship service that we stop and we say to the Lord, Lord, what we've brought to you through our online giving, what we've brought to you through our offerings in our connect group, what we'll drop into the offering box as we walk out into the lobby, whatever we give, Lord, may it be found acceptable in your sight. And Lord, would you receive this as an offering, a praise offering, that we're thanking you for what you've done for us, and we understand that all good and perfect gifts come from the Father above. It's a matter of praising the Lord and thanking the Lord for what he's done. But then you come to the last thing. There's the privilege of giving, and the pleasure of giving, and the profit of giving, and the praise of giving. Here's number five, though. It's verse 19, and it's one of the most beautiful verses in all of the Bible. It's the promise of giving. It's the promise of giving. Look at what he says in verse 19. And my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Now, I dare say that that is probably one of the most misconstrued, misused passages that you'll find anywhere. It's a beautiful promise. It is beloved by all of God's people. But I dare say that the prosperity preachers, you know the ones I'm talking about, the name it and claim it, blab it and grab it guys, all of those who just say that God is your magic lamp, and you just rub the lamp right and hold your foot right and hold your tongue right, and God will give you whatever you ask for, and he's got to do it because he promised. They are taking it totally out of context. Totally out of context. Never just pull a passage out of the Bible, out of its context, and try to make it say what you want it to say. What is the context of this passage? What he has just said is, look, folks, I wasn't standing beside the mailbox twiddling my thumbs waiting on this. I wasn't fearful that if you didn't send this to me, that I was going to starve to death. God was going to provide for my needs one way or the other. Still, that's why he used that word. Still, you did it and I appreciate it. But here's what I want you to understand. God met my need through you. And God is going to meet your need. Now, here's what Paul understood about human nature. Human nature is that when we give something, sometimes something happens a few weeks later or a few months later. You know, Johnny needs braces, or in their case, maybe one of the spokes broke off on the chariot and it's going to be a little costly to get that fixed. They've got an expense that they didn't see coming. And all of a sudden, somebody starts to think, well, you know, I gave all that money to the church. You know, I gave all that money to Paul. I sent that special offering. And if I just kept that, if I just kept that, I could use that now, and I wouldn't have this need. This is what Paul is saying. Look, God provided for my need. And God used you to provide for my need. But God is going to provide for your need in the same way. Now, sometimes we confuse our wants and our needs, don't we? Sometimes we confuse our wants and our needs. I think sometimes we just get all caught up in wanting more of stuff. We just want more material things. And when somebody else gets something, we want it too. We want a little bit more. This passage doesn't say God will provide everything you want. It says God will provide your needs. Now, let me tell you something. Now listen to me real close. I want you to listen. When you came to church today, if you had to decide which car you were coming in, are we taking your car or my car or the extra one in the garage? If you had to walk around a wave runner or a boat or an RV to get to your car, if you've got another pair of shoes at home right now other than the pair you're wearing, if you've got any other clothes besides what's on your back right now, and I imagine some of us have clothes that we just wear at Christmas. I know some of us have shirts that we just wear on July 4th. They're so ugly, we wouldn't wear them any other time. If you've got any food in your cupboard, your freezer, and you're really not worried that you might starve to death this week because you don't know that you'll have food to eat as the week goes, if the answer to those things I just said is yes, you are richer than 95% of the people on planet Earth. And our problem usually is not our needs. Our problem's our wants. Now look at what he says there in verse 19. It's an incredible verse. It's a wonderful promise. And you ought not make a promise you're not going to keep, right? You can't make a child a promise you're not going to keep. You promise your child you're going to be at the ball game at 7 o'clock tonight. If you're not there, it really doesn't matter if the traffic was heavy, and it really doesn't matter if you're most valuable client called and needed you to do something. All the child knows is that you promised and you're not there. Better not make a promise that you can't keep. This promise is, my God, my God. See the personal nature of that? We've been studying Psalm 23 on Wednesday nights. You remember how it starts? The Lord is, what's the word? My shepherd. It didn't say the Lord is the shepherd or the Lord is a shepherd. It says the Lord is my shepherd. It's personal. That's what this passage says. My God who can provide for all of your needs, my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. I think that's spiritual. Not just salvation. He does that when we call to him. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. I think it goes beyond that. You know, I learned a long time ago that I was on the wrong side oftentimes. I was on the wrong side of temptation and sin when I was coming to the Lord. And I was claiming a promise, but the promise I was claiming was 1 John 1:9. And I found myself over and over having to come to the Lord saying, Lord, I know I told you I'd never do that again, but here I am. And I know 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And Lord, I'm confessing my sin and I'm claiming your forgiveness. I think we need to get on the other side of that temptation. That's why Jesus taught us in the model prayer when they said, Lord, teach us to pray. That's why Jesus said, pray like this. And one of the things he said was, lead us not into temptation. In other words, Lord, help me to keep that from happening. Get on this side of the temptation. It's a spiritual blessing that he wants to give. It's a relational blessing. You know, the psalmist said, I think it's the 42nd Psalm, the psalmist said, as the deer pants for the water, as the deer pants for the water, so my soul. Imagine an animal that's been running and their tongue is hanging out and they're desperate for water. He said, as the animal is desperate for water, so my soul is desperate for you. It's relational and it's material. He will provide your needs. Now let me tell you something and I'll be done. If I were to write a check, two checks. Bruce, I'm going to give you a choice here. I'm going to write a check to you for $1,000, and I'm going to write a check to you for $1,000,000. Which one do you want? You'll take the $1,000. You know why? Because he heard this sermon in the last hour. See if I ask you in the next hour. Now, he made the right choice. You know why he made the right choice? Because I don't have $1 million. And I could make that check for $1 million. I could make it for $10 million. I could make it for $1 billion. You just tell me the number. I can make that check out, and it's absolutely worthless because I don't have it. He picked the 1,000 because I have $1,000. And so $1,000 is worth more than nothing, no matter what the other said. This passage says, my God will supply all your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And let me tell you something about his riches and glory. My God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. This is my Father's world. And one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess to the glory of God the Father that Jesus is Lord. And my God has promised that he will meet all your needs. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the promise. It's not a promise from the preacher, a promise from a group. It's a promise from the creator of the universe that when we live our lives trusting you, when we live according to your plan, when we do what you have told us to do, you will supply our needs. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you will help us always to be a church that looks beyond ourselves, that we see a bigger picture than just right here. And I pray, Lord, that we would be a church filled with people who understand that we are blessed beyond measure. We are rich in any measure that this world affords. And that you have promised, relationally, spiritually, materially, in every way, you have promised to meet our needs when we trust you. I pray, Heavenly Father, for someone who's struggling today, for someone who really needs a touch of the Lord's hand in their heart and life. I pray that this would be a day that they would open their heart to you and that they would turn to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together. Pastor Bruce and I are here waiting. This is a time when you can become a part of our church. It's a time when you can come and let one of us pray with you and for you. It's a time when you can respond as God has spoken to your heart. Let's sing.
Lord Jesus, I long to be perfectly whole. I want you forever to live in my soul. Break down every idol and cast out every foe. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow, yes, whiter. Jesus, look down from your throne in the skies and help me to make a complete sacrifice. I give up myself and whatever I know. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow, yes, whiter.
Haven't we been blessed through the study of Philippians over the last months? Incredible, incredible study. And I'm glad we're going to 1 John because Philippians is just full of notes, and I don't have room for any more notes in Philippians. I'm going to have to get a new Bible to study Philippians again. But looking forward to this new study in 1 John after the first of the year. Again, to the guests, we're so glad you're here today. Please come by and let the pastor and me thank you for being here. We want to get to know you and just welcome you to First Baptist Church. Don't forget, during this Christmas season, the gifts we're making as a church to honor loved ones, to memorialize others, or perhaps just in generosity, is through the Gideon Organization for the Purchase of Bibles. One of the great organizations that we partner alongside the Gideons. Nobody has the ability to distribute Bibles like the Gideons. And we have so many men in our church part of that organization. Let's give generously. There are tables out in the foyer to make your contributions at the end of the service. Greg?
I'm looking for every one of you this Saturday or Sunday. If you don't like the program, I'm going to give you your money back. Invite somebody to come with you, and let's fill this room up Saturday and Sunday. We start at 6. I hope you'll be here. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, his name is called Emmanuel. God with us, revealed in us, his name is called Emmanuel. Have a great week. See you next time.
Your